Data Skeptic mini-episodes provide high-level descriptions of key concepts related to data science and skepticism.
Today's topic is boosting.
So Linda, let's just do some background review really quick. Are you comfortable with the topic decision trees?
Yeah, it's like branches and you make a decision and, and it leads you down a path.
We've covered this stuff a lot. What about weak and strong learners?
I don't know what you mean by that. Why don't you tell me?
All right, so a weak learner is a model you build where the goal is not necessarily to really capture your data set to learn it, but with a limited number of features or training time or whatever, come up with something that's like, gets it right some of the time.
It's a model?
Yeah, it's a model that you don't spend too much time on, basically.
So what other people call it, like a prototype?
In a way, but you use weak learners in a different way. So maybe we should compare it to strong learners. What would you think if that's my definition of weak learner? What's a strong learner?
Maybe something that does the job really well.
Yeah. So the formal definition of a strong learner is that one is really trying to minimize the error between its predictions and the output within some very strong control. And it'll do that by maybe adding complexity to its model. The weak learner, on the other hand, is sort of saying, close enough. I get it right some of the time, but I'm a simple model. Weak learners were used a lot in random forests that we've discussed in the last two mini episodes, but they show up lots of places. You can build lots of little simple models. So in comparison to random forest, which is like a group of these, today we're going to talk about AdaBoost, or adaptive boosting, which is one of a member of a larger class called the AnyBoost framework. And AdaBoost is very exemplary of that class. So at a high level, AdaBoost makes one weak learner, and then it kind of looks back and says, how good did it do? And it looks at the points it got right and the points it got wrong. Anything it got wrong, it'll say, all right, let's make those points more important. Let's weight them higher. And the points it got right, let's weight them a little bit less. And then let's train a new weak learner with these new weights. So the next iteration is going to focus on the mistakes of the past iteration.
Why is that?
It's kind of a learning theory thing. The idea is that you're going to assemble all these weak learners together. So if the 10th iteration says, I got you covered on 80% of the cases, but I make mistakes on 20%. Well, then those 20% are the most important because whatever you've learned so far doesn't adequately describe those. So you want to learn some new aspect of the data in the future iterations.
So you're saying a person who makes a weak learner, that's typically their goal.
The weak learner is just trying to be in the moment in one iteration and say, here's a training data set and it's weighted, which in other words, some of those points are more important than others. Can I learn a simple model that tries to predict as accurately as it can under some constraints, a nice simple weak learner model that describes that data? Now we talk about restaurants every so often on this show, and you keep up on the latest restaurants, right?
I just go to Eater LA and look up restaurants.
Oh, so there's only one source that explains all these great places you take me to?
Yeah, I like Eater.
All right, well, not all restaurants survive.
No, not in LA.
What's the fastest you've seen a restaurant close?
Well, the fastest is probably I've never seen it.
There's definitely a turnover, though. Like, we see a lot of places that last 2 or 3 years, maybe, and then they're gone.
Mm-hmm.
An interesting problem might be trying to predict if a restaurant will have long-term success, maybe if they'll survive to 5 years. That'd be kind of interesting thing to study, right?
Yeah, I mean, if you're a restaurateur,
you should
know whether you should invest in it.
Yeah.
Because it costs so much to open it.
Right. In classic machine learning, you would just say, assemble a big training set of data, take all the restaurants that, over the past 5 years, get a bunch of information about them, like, what type of cuisine they had, what neighborhood they were in, how much money they had to start with, all these different things that might be important. And then you label them as, lasted 5 years or not. Let's just call that success and failure. And then you would throw a machine learning algorithm at it and see if it can find a model. In boosting, it's a little different. It's kind of like saying, let's make a real quick weak learner. So an example of a weak learner might be, if the restaurant is a chain, say it's a success. If it's a non-chain, then predict it's going to fail. So how good of a prediction do you think that would be?
Bad.
Better or worse than a coin toss?
Better.
All right, so it's not terrible, but it's a starting point. It's going to get some restaurants right.
Yeah, I mean, obviously there's LA chains, and they seem to be doing pretty well, generally speaking.
And there is a lot of non-chains that do fail, so it's not necessarily something we want to take to an investor and can convince them to buy our model here, but we're off to a good start. So what do we want to do the next time if we want to train another weak learner? we'd want to capture the cases that we got wrong the first time. So what you do is you downweight the cases you got right and you upweight the cases you got wrong. And then because all the wrong cases are more important to you, you probably would come up with a slightly different model. Like maybe the next model looks at whether or not the restaurant was started by someone who had prior experience in the restaurant industry. Maybe two or three other features, but a simple model that focuses on the ones you got wrong before. Mm-hmm. And then you can do that again, right? For the third round, you can upweight those that were missed in the previous round. If the first and second models both got it wrong, now that weight's going to be a lot higher, and it'll keep going up and up and up until maybe it would be so important that the next week learner says, hey, I have to learn this one data point because we've been screwing up so much. We got to get these subcases right. Mm-hmm. And so maybe at that point, a few iterations in, you start to learn really interesting novel corner cases like, oh, Italian restaurants only work in the valley if they serve fish or some, you know, crazy thing like that. And a general model might not pick up on things like that because you're going to penalize it for getting too complex. But if you iterate, this is the process of AdaBoost, upweight the things you got wrong before, downweight the things you got right, train a new weak learner, and then you have this series of weak learners. And you can weight all of those as well because some of them will have been really good and, you know, covered a lot of base cases, and some of them will be worse later on. So the whole AnyBoost family is all about how do you up and down weight, you know, what function do you use to do that, and then when you have all these weak learners, how do you combine them?
Okay, so how is this different from, remember, you have like a team of different models, and then you just aggregate, and they all vote.
Yeah, good question. That's like the random forest and other techniques like that. Those rely on the bootstrap to get their sample, which is a statistical technique we'll get into in the future, but also they kind of can run in parallel because they're not dependent upon one another. In AdaBoost, it's a sequential process where you're trying to learn from the mistakes of the past in a way.
I see. Sequential.
Yeah. But very, very good idea. These are similar, very similar in concept, the bagging and boosting. They're just different in the way they sample and in some of the algorithmic techniques. But at a very high level, yes, they're groups of models or way to assemble groups of weak learners.
So I'm not sure what boosting is.
Boosting is the process. Oh, why do they call it boosting? Yeah, I never really explained that. It's called boosting because you start with some model, like a weak learner, and it's like, well, it's pretty good, but it's not great. How do we amp it up? How do we take it to the next level? Let's make this model extreme.
I think Kyle's thinking about taking steroids.
Actually, I was imitating an energy drink commercial, but I guess it's the same thing.
To me, I was like Arnold Schwarzenegger.
I'm going to pump you up.
Yeah, I was like, oh my goodness.
No, so it's you're boosting it because you're taking the things it was bad at and kind of trying to push them up. You boost the weights of how important it is to learn training cases you've been missing in the past.
Speaking of boosting, okay, so boosting is taking something and taking it up to the next level. Is that what AdaBoosting is?
Well, that's not the takeaway I'd like you to have. The takeaway for me is that AdaBoost is how you train a series of weak learners using this technique.
Okay, so that's AdaBoost.
Or if you want to learn just a nickel version of it, it's improving upon the mistakes of the misclassifications of past models. So here's one, if I were to criticize it, I'm going to make a little bit of a straw man argument here, but you could say, well, AdaBoost sounds like a series of really stupid predictors. You're going to make a simple model that we know is not very good, and then you're going to make another simple model that tries to fix the first simple model, and a simple model after that tries to fix the one after him. Why don't you just get one really smart person that knows what they're doing, and wouldn't they do better than a series of not very smart models?
I don't know. Why?
I guess we'd have to formalize our criticism a little bit more to really get to the bottom of it. But no, as it turns out, empirically, and for some theoretical reasons that I'd refer people to the elements of statistical learning to know more about.
Okay, so all these techniques are kind of like different engine models or something, right? Like,
yeah.
Techniques you use.
Yeah. You can think of it this way. Every machine learning algorithm maps from some input, some large set of inputs, to some output. The purpose of machine learning is to find the best mapping.
Well, I'm going to remember boosting, like, you know, in Mario Kart when they ride over the rumble strips and they get a boost. They will go boom, boom. I don't even know what sound it makes. It's been so long. And they probably make new sounds now, but it's like or something.
Well, that's correct intuitively. Yes, you're likely to improve your model if you explore boosting. But I think maybe the better takeaway is that it's a technique that's iterative, trying to focus on the things that you got wrong previously.
So it's like a decision tree, but with little weak models.
Yeah, you could make a lot of decision trees, one at each step, and then they're weighted by how good they are, and each one is trying to pick up on the mistakes of the last one. And until next time, I just want to remind everyone to keep thinking skeptically of and with data. Good night, Linda.
Good night.
More on this episode, visit dataskeptic.com. If you enjoyed the show, please give us a review on iTunes or Stitcher.